Hello, 3D printing friends. Today on the BV3D channel, we'll get a look at the Elegoo Neptune 3 Max. Oh, why is it sideways? Because it's so big, that's the only way it fits on the table. We'll talk more about it right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. Hi, welcome back. Okay, so today we're getting a look at the Elegoo Neptune 3 Max. Big thanks to Elegoo for sending this over free of charge so I could show it to you. And I turned it so it's facing forward, but it is hanging off the back of the table. Anyway, I've been using this enormous printer for a little while now. I feel like it's mostly underutilized because I just don't print huge things most of the time. I did print one thing that uses the full build height, and it's legit the tallest single part I've ever printed. And we'll get a look at it during the print and show and tell later. So in this video, we'll go over the printer's specs, test out some of its features, take a look at the things that I printed with it, and talk about the things that I like and don't like about the printer. In other words, the typical BV3D review video. Okay, let's get right into the specs. The Neptune 3 Max has the largest build volume of any 3D printer I've gotten to use so far. The build volume is an absolutely enormous 420 millimeters on the X-axis, 420 millimeters on the Y-axis, and 500 millimeters on the Z-axis. It has a dual gear direct drive extruder with a 3-to-1 gear ratio. It comes standard with a 0.4 millimeter nozzle. The maximum nozzle temperature is 260 degrees Celsius, and the maximum bed temperature is 100 degrees Celsius. And it has a textured PEI-coated spring steel sheet on a magnetic bed, which makes models easy to remove. It also has automatic mesh bed leveling, and because this is such a huge bed, it samples a 63-point grid, 7 points by 9 points, to map out the high and low spots. It has dual Z-axis stepper motors and a 32-bit mainboard with silent stepper motor drivers. It's silent when it's idle and cool with all the fans off, and it's not too loud when it's printing either. The loudest things on the printer are the fans. In particular, the fan on the 500-watt power supply inside the case. It has a tethered 4.3-inch color touchscreen. It has a built-in light bar. There's an LED strip under the top crossbar to light up the print area. There are belt tensioners on the X and Y axes. It has a tool drawer, along with the usual kit of tools, complete with flush cutters. And it has a price tag comfortably under $500. Okay, let's get into the prints. Before we do, though, I want to mention that the version of Cura that Elegoo bundles with their FDM printers is an older version 4 edition. But since Cura 5.3 now includes the Neptune printer configurations from Naruto FZR, and since Cura 5.3 is the current version, it gets updates and bug fixes that the older version 4 does not. So all these models were sliced using Cura 5.3 except for the first one, because that was a sample model. And that's this one. This little Buddha model is the first thing I printed on the Neptune 3 Max because it's the one Elegoo included on the card, and it's the only one I didn't slice myself. It printed in an hour and 30 minutes. All of its little details came out really good, so I'm really happy with it. This Calicat printed in 48 minutes, and it looks pretty good. I didn't get any stringing, and the 45-degree overhang on the tail looks good, which usually means the part's cooling fans are doing a good job. I'm pretty happy with how it turned out. Next up, this is a stand-up peep bunny from Chelsea at Chaos Cortec. I printed several of these to decorate around the house for Easter. Looking really closely at it, I can see some ringing, but it's not terrible. I can also see the Z seam going up the right-hand side of it. The Z seam is where each layer starts, and it shows up more with some filaments than others. But overall, it's a great little peep bunny, and there wasn't any stringing. Okay, now, here's the Filinium Malkin. This one has been around for a while, and it's been a long time since I printed it. After I printed it, I found out there's a newer edition of the model in multiple parts and with tons more detail. But I had this old version of it on my hard drive, and so that's what I went with. It prints standing on its tail, so it's got a flat spot, but if you're parking it on a shelf facing forward, that won't show. I noticed some ringing that shows up pretty clearly on the Malkin. Also, the back of the dish mount didn't come out super clean, but there are also a lot of little details that did turn out fine. And even though it's hard to tell in these shots, there are seats in the cockpit and stuff. Anyway, this one is going to go on the shelf behind me with the AT-ATs and the other sci-fi models. Next is a regulation-sized desktop trash can designed by me. This gets sliced in vase mode, where the slicer creates a file that prints the bottom layers normally, and then only prints the outer edge of the model as a spiral, going from the bottom to the top. Prusa Slicer calls this feature spiral vase mode, and Cura refers to the feature as spiralize outer contour, so look for those in your slicer's print settings to enable it. I set the extrusion width to 0.8 millimeters, which is perfectly okay to do even with a 0.4 millimeter nozzle. That gave me a double thick, single wall print that's nice and sturdy. I think it turned out pretty good. I like keeping these next to my printers to hold the little priming lines and skirts and things that you pull off the bed between prints. I also usually have one on my desk for the little bits of stuff that I need to throw away, but I'm too lazy to reach under the desk for the real trash can. So I figured as long as I was printing things with a 0.8 millimeter wide extrusion width in vase mode, I would print this rocket plane that I like by Mech G. But instead of printing it at the usual small size, I scaled it up to the full 500 millimeter build height. The model is weirdly faceted, but that's because I didn't use the right one for scaling up. At normal scale, you likely wouldn't notice it, but at this size, it shows. So while the wings look smooth, the fuselage looks like it was roughly hammered out of iron. It's actually kind of a cool look in a way. Anyway, this is the tallest single-piece model I've ever printed, and it came out great. Now, here's a MacGyver Caladragon. This printed pretty well, although there's a little bit of stringing between the antlers, and also between the tip of the tail and the body. But it's just a few little wispy things, so it's no big deal. The model printed really well, with no issues on the overhangs, like the chin. The backs of the antlers turned out fine, too. I like this little model because it's a more organic design than the Calicat, but I still also like the Calicat. So I also printed the Caladragon in some yellow TPU. The stringing is definitely more pronounced here, as sometimes happens with TPU, because it's a rubbery, flexible filament. But that can easily be snipped away, and I could also experiment with the retraction settings to get a better result. Apart from the stringing, though, the model printed really well with a nice surface finish. And it's squishy, too. The last print I have to show you is this Orange Pi 3 LTS case, which is my remix of a Raspberry Pi 4 case by Squirrel Brain on printables.com. This case prints in 5 pieces and then screws together. It has a cool, ruggedized look to it, with plenty of room inside for the fan and the heat sinks. I really like the texture that the bed leaves on the prints. And the design of the case itself is a favorite of mine. Squirrel Brain did a great job on it. Hey, just popping in real quick from the editing room. I hope you're enjoying the video. If you don't mind, I have a quick favor to ask. If you're getting value out of this video, please click that subscribe button, because I'm trying to get the channel to the 100,000 subscriber milestone by the end of the year, and I need your help to do it. Thanks a bunch. Sorry for the interruption, and now back to the video. So I tested the power loss recovery feature, and hey, it works! I started printing a CHEP cube, and after it had been running for a bit, I turned off the power. Then I turned it on again a few seconds later. The printer booted, reported a power failure, and asked if I wanted to resume, so I said, yes please. The printer got the bed and nozzle back to temperature, homed the X and Y axes, and resumed printing. And this is the CHEP cube. This one little loop of filament and this line is the only evidence that power went out during the print. Then I tested the filament runout sensor. I cut the filament going into the sensor. When it ran out, the printer paused, beeped a lot to get my attention, and prompted me to load more. So I reloaded the filament and continued the print. And here's the resulting CHEP cube. There's an under-extruded layer where the print resumed, but I think that's preferable to losing a print. So, as I like to say, the filament runout sensor will let you know when you need to run out and get more. Well, now let's get into what I like and what I don't like about the printer, starting with the things I like. First off, I like the size and the fact that this can print huge objects in a single pass. You can easily fit helmets on this printer. This Mando helmet wasn't printed on the Max, I'm just using it to give a sense of scale. I also like the tool drawer, and I would like to see more printers include them. It gives you a handy place to keep the wrenches and spare nozzles and flush cutters and stuff. It's easy to put together following the assembly video that comes on the microSD card with the printer. It's a 10-minute video that covers unpacking and assembly and wiring and adjusting the V-slot wheels and leveling or tramming the bed and loading filament and printing from the card. The 63-point mesh bed leveling works well, and after I did the initial leveling, I haven't had to run it since. I like the texture on the PEI flex plate because that texture transfers to printed models and helps to make them look like professionally made parts. And I like the direct drive extruder. It's really easy to load and it hasn't given me any trouble. I also like that the heat break cooling fan on the tool head turns off when the nozzle is below 50 degrees Celsius. It helps to keep the printer quiet when it's not being used. And as with the Neptune 3 Plus, I like the design. The blue-gray color on the gantry is nice, and the injection-molded plastic front panel also looks good. Okay, now the first thing in the likes list is also the first thing in the dislikes list, and that's the sheer size of the printer. It's so big I had to turn it sideways on the workbench to fit, like you saw in the intro. The printer itself is about 24 inches deep, but it needs about 32 inches of depth to accommodate the bed moving back. And if you're going to enclose it somehow, you'd need like 39 inches to accommodate the bed's full range of motion from fully back to fully forward. And it's 39 inches tall with a spool of filament on top and about 28 inches wide with the screen there. Now, even though it's a huge printer, that's not a huge dislike. Frankly, if you're looking at buying a large format printer like this, you're most likely taking its operational footprint into consideration. But its size can make finding a place for it somewhat awkward. Now, just like on the Neptune 3 Plus, sometimes after a print is finished, removing the microSD card causes the bed to move to the back of the printer. It doesn't happen every time I remove the card, but it's weird. And it seems like once the power supply fan turns on, it takes a really long time to turn off again. I have found that once the printer's cooled down after a print, I can power cycle it to get the PSU fan to stop sooner than it otherwise would have. So let's start wrapping things up. This is pretty much an even larger version of the Elegoo Neptune 3 Plus that I showed a couple of months ago. Everything is the same, it's just a bigger printer. Same extruder, same bed type, same assembly steps, same touchscreen, new tool drawer, so I like that. I still think the Plus needs a tool drawer. And you get a lot of printer for the money. That's actually not a pun, even though, yeah, it literally is a lot of printer. I mean, it's a pretty good value for the money. So far, the Neptune 3 product line has really impressed me. The only problem with the Neptunes seems to be getting your hands on one. They seem to be in short supply, and the next batch for the US is expected to ship in late May. Still, if you're interested in checking out the Neptune 3 Max on Elegoo's site, there's a link to it in the description. Thanks again to Elegoo for sending this printer over for review, and a big thanks to everyone who supports the channel, whether with channel memberships or by using the links in the description. If you liked this episode, give it a thumbs up, and maybe consider subscribing so you don't miss future videos. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this one. And now that we're at the end, let's go print something cool. And big. The blue-gray color on the gantry is nice, and the injection-molded front plastic. Come on, Brian.